50 years ago, in 1933, Ukraine suffered one of the most cruel acts of barbarity in the history of humanity. Million people, more than 25% of the Ukrainian population of that time, died of hunger in an artificial famine that had been entirely premeditated and deliberately imposed upon them. Yet this Holocaust is one of the least known and most hidden episodes of Soviet terror. In fact, the famine of 1933 was not the first one in Ukraine. There also had been a famine in 1921-22, and there are certain analogies and contrasts between these two famines. The famine of 1921-22 started in Russia, mainly in the region of the Volga, where bad crops had caused a serious lack of food. This famine then spread into southern Ukraine. And while the government soon acknowledged the famine in Russia, it did not do so in the case of Ukraine until much later. And in the meantime, it exported Ukrainian wheat to feed the Russian population around the Volga, thus causing the Ukrainian people of the steppes to die of hunger.
Le blé était envoyé en Russie pour nourrir cette population.
Have members of your family died in this famine?
З моєї родини тяжко.
Перед час.
То є батько і матір. 21 особи. І згинуло. А в тому числі мій рідний брат.
On my father's side and my mother's, 21 persons died, including my brother. There was no food, but I was working because I had falsified my papers. My brother had stayed in the village and had fallen sick. I was told this, and I asked for 3 days of leave to go see him. The village was 35 kilometers from the collective farm where I was working. When I arrived, I found my brother lying on the floor by the stove. He couldn't get up. He was all swollen. I said, "Alexa, what's wrong?" He answered, "When Sergei was alive, we caught dogs and cats, which we ate. But now there's nothing left. Sergei is dead, and it shouldn't be long for me." He couldn't get up. He was too weak. His feet and hands were swollen.
Я каже, той Сергій вже, каже, ноги витягнув, а я, каже, не сьогодні, завтра. А вже вставати не вставав. Ноги понапихали отаково, руки. Я подивився.
I left. What else could I do? If I wasn't back at work on time, I would lose my bread ration, 300 grams. So I left. Later, someone told me that my brother was dead.
Я народилася на півдні України, в Одесі.
I was born in Odessa, in southern Ukraine. In 1933, I was 7 years old, so I can remember what my parents talked and worried about. And lack of food was their main concern.
Це була більше журба за харчі.
The novelty of this particular famine, and it is the basic point about it, is that what made it so diabolical is that it was not a result of some catastrophe like a drought or something of that sort, or even an epidemic. It was the deliberate creation of a bureaucratic mind which demanded the collectivization of agriculture immediately as a purely theoretical proposition without any consideration whatever of what would be the consequences in human suffering.
Мої батьки про це згадали тому, що голод 33-го року був настільки жахливий, що були випадки канібалізму.
My parents remember that sometimes mothers sacrificed one of their children so that the rest of the family would not die of hunger.
Від голодної смерті і себе, і інших дітей, якщо їх було в родині багато.
Я бачив по станціях, бачив я, це мені неприємно говорити це, але це правда. І цю правду треба сказати.
I don't like to talk about that, but the truth has to come out. One day when I was stealing coal off a train, they arrested a woman who was carrying in her suitcase a child cut up in pieces. It took me a while to understand. Now I realize it was cannibalism. It was a terrible experience.
Тепер я це розумію. Тоді я не розумів того. Меж канібалізму. Це була абсолютно страшна подія.
Розкажіть нам про трагедію.
Tell us about the tragedy in Ukraine in 1932-33. To talk about those horrible years, it was the Holocaust in Ukraine. An artificial famine provoked by the Kremlin gang. To talk about that, you have to go back further in time to the period of collectivization that ended in a tragedy in
1929. У 1929 році розкрикулювали багатше селянство.
They collectivized the richest peasants and deported them. My father belonged to the middle class. He had a cow and two horses and 3.5 acres of land. They arrested him and threw him in jail. It was winter in January.
Його за це арестували. Повезли в тюрму. Це була зима.
My mother went and brought him warm clothes because he was being deported to Siberia. While she was gone, two activists came to our house. They took everything there was in the house and dragged us outside, my two sisters and I. I don't remember his name, but he was an engineer. They dragged us in the snow, they closed the house and left us there. What could we do? We went to the barn, all three of us, and slept in the hay until our mother came back, late in the night.
Але інженер був, пам'ятаю. Вивели нас на сніг. Снігу було повно. І хату замкнули. І ми лишилися на снігу. Що робити? Ми тоді утроє пішли у хлів, в стайню. І так у соломі ми і спали. Поки мати прийшла пізнім вечором.
She took us to our aunt in the middle of the night. After spending those hours in the cold, my sister Marika fell sick. She died 2 weeks later.
Простудилася, мігрень дістала. За 2 тижні і вона померла.
La définition de kulak, en effet, en pratique, entre 1930 et 31.
The word kulak in 1930-31 had in practice a political meaning and a rather preposterous one. For example, anyone who owned a small motor was called kulak. If we look at the families in the villages who hired laborers, they were the widows and the invalids, those who couldn't work their land themselves and had to hire help. That was their definition of kulak. I think it was a rather absurd concept.
De main d'œuvre, dont selon la définition, c'était un kulak. Je pense que c'est une c'est une absurde, un concept assez absurde. Et c'est si on regarde la résistance contre la collectivisation en 1930,
it is a well-known fact, and even the Russian historian Yakosevsky said it, that the greatest opposition to collectivization was amongst the peasants who had just gone through their revolution to obtain their land, and amongst the middle peasant class who had just pulled themselves out of poverty.
Faisait la révolution pour obtenir des terres, et parmi les couches paysannes moyennes, qui, spécialement ceux qui se sont élevés de la pauvreté.
I think this is implicit in the Ukrainian word for the famine, stuchny holod, that this was an artificial famine, that there was no famine in a sense of a crop failure, which would have caused people to starve, but that the food was literally taken out of the villages, that people were left to starve as a result of deliberate government policy. And that's what's unique about the Ukrainian famine, the fact that it was not some sort of natural disaster, but a government policy, or the result of a government policy.
Whatever the reasons for the famine in Ukraine, they were always accompanied by deportations.
Він супроводжується ще й депортаціями, вивезенням населення.
There were, according to estimates I have read, 1.2 million Ukrainians who were dekulakized, that is, whose farms were expropriated and who were shipped to Siberia.
En 1933, l'intelligentsia ukrainienne était...
In 1933, there was a massive purge of the Ukrainian intelligentsia. According to Yuri Levnayenko, 80% of the intelligentsia of Ukraine were liquidated, artists, writers, poets. And of course, the reason why they were executed is that they were against the collectivization and the famine.
S'opposer évidemment à la collectivisation et à la famine.
What happened with the church? The church lost its supporting base in the districts of Ukraine where the famine was most severe. Wherever collectivization was introduced, the priests were driven out and the churches were closed. Priests were even forbidden to visit the collectivized regions of Ukraine.
Візити в ці колективізовані райони. Під кінець 30-х років, між 30...
Between 1937 and 38, those remaining bishops and priests, together with the more active lay people that had not been arrested, were liquidated.
Часу не було арештовані, які вже фактично не служили чи не брали активної участі. Так що із вибухом німецько-совєтської війни.
Thus, at the outbreak of the German-Soviet War, when the German troops entered Ukraine, there were no more than 10 or 12 active Orthodox churches left, out of the 14,000 churches that existed at the time of the revolution. The destruction of all religious groups was tremendous.
Якщо в Україні виникає голод, якому б то не було році, в 21-му, 33-му чи 46-му,
in 1921, as much as in 1933 or 1946, each time there was a famine in Ukraine, the state that annexed Ukraine by force, the state that we call today a superpower, the Soviet Union, has never helped to feed the population. On the contrary, it totally controlled the food staples thanks to a particular system of centralization. If they had wanted to, those responsible could have brought help to the famished population, especially since it was a regional phenomenon. But that state and its representatives, the elite of the party, were more concerned with making sure that the famished people respected the norms of productivity on the collective farms. We have experienced food scarcity in Ukraine well after 1946 and 1947. For example, in 1964, all staples suddenly disappeared from all stores for almost a year.
Раптом зникли з крамниць, можна сказати, всі харчі.
How was the famine concealed?
Well, the Soviet regime at this time spared no effort to conceal what it was doing in the countryside, and it was very important for it to do this. It was, first of all, exporting the grain to the West. There's a whole literature of Soviet grain dumping in this period, and it was important to them from an economic standpoint to deny that they were literally taking this grain, which they were selling, out of the mouths of starving people. Secondly, it was important for them to maintain a certain amount of sympathy in the West, and the maintenance of this sympathy itself was crucial to the concealment of the famine. The famine is part of a larger policy, which also extends to the cities, extends to the Ukrainian intelligentsia, to the Ukrainian political elite. That is, in this period, one witnesses the destruction of the Ukrainian cultural intelligentsia, of the spiritual intelligentsia, of the church, the removal of and destruction of many of the visible reminders of Ukraine's past. There's a literature on the lost architecture of Kiev, the destruction of Ukrainian politics in the Soviet Union. And all these things fit together in an attempt to break the Ukrainians as a social entity, a social organism, and a political factor within the context of the Soviet Union.
Who are the perpetrators of this famine?
Well, the main perpetrator, in my estimation, was Stalin. The policies which created the famine and which worsened it, which led it to its conclusion, were made in the highest circles of the Soviet political elite. That is the only place they could be made. The famine was the result of excessive grain procurements quotas against the Ukrainian Republic. These quotas seem to have been designed to break the countryside as a social basis of Ukrainian nationalism. It went hand in hand with a massive purge of the Ukrainian cultural elite, with the destruction of the Communist Party of Ukraine, or at least of its Ukrainian wing, the destruction of Ukrainian politics, Ukraine as a political factor inside the Soviet Union.
And yet there's an awful lot of these people who have perpetuated this crime still walking the streets of Moscow. Who are these people?
Many of them are still in the political leadership of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. Under Khrushchev and since his time, Soviet scholars have talked about, or scholars of the Soviet Union in the West have talked about the so-called Dnipropetrovsk Mafia. That is the elite that was brought to power on Khrushchev's coattails, including Brezhnev, were Donbass Russians. And these are the people who took part in creating the famine. It's the same group which provided the Ukrainian countryside with these thousanders, with these plenipotentiaries which took out the grain. I mean, the people, if you ask what happened to the people who committed any Ukrainian genocide, the answer is that they are in power in the Soviet Union today.
Stalin devoted himself to that system to which we have all participated. I would even say that Stalin was the most diabolical, and all those that surrounded him, Kaganovich, Voroshilov, Molotov, they were all diabolical. I was also part of that group. I was young and stupid. We have all created that system.
I think the difference between Lenin and Stalin was quantitative, but not qualitative. Stalin killed many more people than Lenin had, but Lenin was prepared to kill his political opponents as well. It wasn't a difference of philosophy. It was a matter of Stalin's greater efficiency as a murderer.
Людина шукає, бо знає, що можна знайти. За чим вона шукає? За свободою, за ідеалами, за чимось високим.
An individual looks for what he knows he may be able to find. He isn't looking for freedom or ideals, but food. He is lowered to the state of an animal who will lick the hand of whoever has given him food. This is a tragedy. It means that many generations of a population are led strictly by their physiological needs. In other words, they are led by their stomach.
Від того, що вони для своєї задоволення своїх фізіологічних потреб мають. Виявляються залежними від свого шлунку, фактично. Отже, в періоди голоду, коли фактично відсутні харчі, і їх майже неможливо здобути, в той час загроза фізичного існування населення, для загроза для фізичної субстанції нації.
Il y a une certaine analogie de exploitation de la population de l'Ukraine par le centre Moscou.
Moscow considered and treated Ukraine as a colony. The famine in Russia was real. There was a genuine lack of food. But since there was a lack of food in Ukraine as well as in Russia, the government chose to sacrifice the population of Ukraine to help the population of Russia.
Why is the United Nations ignoring this question?
Well, it's a political reason. The Soviet Union has always sought to align itself with the Third World, and it creates a certain bloc in the Soviet Union. And in the Third World, people look at the myth rather than the reality. The Soviet Union is always saying, we're anti-imperialists, we're against the colonialists, meaning the people who in the past exploited these Third World nations. And there is an old saying that the devil you know always appears worse than the devil you don't know. Well, they know the devil of Western imperialism. And it may be something that is now a part of history because the Western empires have broken up, but they do not have any direct experience with Soviet imperialism. So it is very easy for them to assume that since the Soviet Union is saying, we are your friends, it is easy for them to assume that that is in fact the case.
И вот отношение интеллигенции сейчас осознание своей ошибки. То есть очень многие писатели, скажем,
the intelligentsia starts to realize its mistake. Among the most reputed writers, Alexander Twardovsky, the editor of Novy Mir, who had written a poem in praise of collectivization, saw his own father depossessed of his land and deported. He later understood that all this was unnecessary and in fact had led to catastrophe. It means that the intelligentsia, in my opinion, had a guilt complex and a well-justified one. They understand that their behavior, or that of their fathers, had been at least faulty, if not criminal.
Близких им людей, вот того поколения и отчасти ее поколения, было ошибочно, если не преступно.
Most Western intellectuals, British, French, German, Canadian, American, were pro-Soviet. Stalin said that he was engaged in a great noble experiment for the benefit of all mankind, and they believed him. The primary responsibility for this lay, of course, with Stalin. He began a deliberate campaign of misinforming the West, of suppressing, concealing the facts about the famine as much as possible. This is not surprising. He had good reasons to do so. It was in his own interest to suppress the facts. What is surprising, however, is that institutions in the West, including reputable newspapers and major Western governments, went along with this and helped Stalin, in effect, to conceal the fact that millions of people had died or were dying. Now, when I say major institutions, including newspapers, I have in mind specifically the New York Times, which went along with what Stalin was doing, and whose reporter in Moscow, Walter Duranty, in my view, deliberately misrepresented the facts. I would put it even more strongly, I would say he knowingly lied. Now, another example of this kind of a deliberate cover-up is the British government. I've had an opportunity to study the archival records, and it is clear that in the course of 1933, Whitehall, the British government in London, was informed in great detail about what was going on in Ukraine. British embassy and consular officials in Moscow were sending back detailed dispatches, week by week, day by day, describing ghastly things. It was no secret to people in London, to officials in London, that there was a famine going on, and as some put it, that perhaps as many as 10 million people had died. The same Whitehall officials who had been receiving these reports about the famine situation and agreeing that they were true, now called this an alleged famine. This was the word they used, alleged famine, and said, sorry, we cannot do anything because we have normal relations with the Soviet Union. Thank you.